Okay.
Okay.
Okay, thanks. Welcome everyone to the SOLAR webinar series. We are SOLAR, the Society for Learning Analytics Research, and this is one of our outreach activities that we do now for over a year and which we really enjoy. Our aim is to make a range of topics widely available to the community by inviting researchers in the field and asking them to share their expertise and their research for you to enjoy, and also to build up a repository of webinars that you can view at a later time. And you can find all the recordings on our website. We will post a link in the chat, where we will also post a recording of today's presentation. And we are your hosts. I'm Anushka, joining from Utrecht, and Isabel is my co-host, joining from Latin America. So we're representing all time zones here. We're happy that you stayed up or got up early to join us today. And we will structure the webinar as follows. We will first explain a little bit about the communication rules. We will introduce our speaker, who will give a presentation, and all time that is left within the hour will be spent on the Q&A. So first, some rules to let the webinar run smoothly. Well, we are joining here through Zoom. I think you're all quite familiar with it by now. We mute all of your mics during the talk. And if you have questions during the talk, we ask you to please post them in the chat. Isabel and I will keep an eye on the chat and copy all your questions to a separate document so that we have a list at the end of the questions. If at the end, during the Q&A, you want to ask your question live to Roberto, that's also fine. Then you can raise your hand during the Q&A and we will give you the microphone to ask your question. So please, if questions come up during the talk, then post them in the chat and we will make sure they come back at the end of the session. So that's for how we communicate during the webinar. Now I'm very happy to introduce Roberto, Dr. Roberto Martinez Maldonado. I'm happy that he's here. He is a senior lecturer of learning analytics and human computer interaction at Monash University in Melbourne. And Roberto's work is quite broad. He has worked on, name a few things, collaborative or teamwork analytics, multimodal analytics, data storytelling. And I think what also uniquely identifies his work is that he always employs these techniques in authentic settings. So in really, authentic educational contexts to really make a difference with his research. He's also currently very busy together with Isabel, per coincidence, in organizing the upcoming LAC conference. If you still want to submit, please do so this weekend because the deadline is coming up. And given his busy time schedule, we're especially happy that he was willing to join us today to share his expertise. And today's talk will be about examples from his recent work in the areas of multimodal learning analytics and data storytelling. And he will provide an overview of the rapidly growing interest in human-centered learning analytics and potential ways in which the fields might evolve in the coming years. So really worth staying up late for. And thank you, Roberto. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Anushka, and thank you, everyone, for being present. So let me just share the slides I want to use to show examples, not only for our research, but also from others. So before starting, I would like to first acknowledge the traditional owners of the land in which I'm today, Yakulit Wilam clan of the Boon Wurrung people, the traditional owners of the land where you all are at the moment, which is several places like I saw in the chat. And I would like to pay our respects to the elders past, present, and future. So we acknowledge and respect their continued relationship to the lands upon which we meet. And I think this acknowledgement to country, which we commonly do here in Australia, is really strong, really important, because it reminds us where we're coming from. And one of those powerful tools that we have been using as humans to communicate pretty much everything has been storytelling. So we, as we say, we saw in this quote, we dream in narrative, they dream in narrative, we learn in narrative. That's why I was highlighting. This is the way we evolve biologically and socially, learning from others through stories. And this is very relevant for learning analytics, and the purpose of the talk today is about understanding why we're talking about that storytelling in learning analytics. Well, storytelling is there in many other areas. In journalism, it's really easy to identify. The journalists can shape the way in which people see education. And I was just looking at these two news entries, very recent, just from 2020-2021, where the journalist creates a story about learning styles and pushing this idea that learning styles is something that actually exists. We know that it has been debunked, but you can see the power of reaching lots of people and perpetuating the truth. And I'm not going to go into fake news or fake information on the internet, but I just wanted to highlight the power of storytelling in journalism, but also in our activity. I know that some of us who are connected at the moment, if you're watching this later, maybe you are researchers or you have been involved in writing a paper. And if we see on the left, we have the different steps to create a story. You know, we start with the plot, doing character setting, there's some tension, rising action, climax, and resolution. That is the template for every story. And if we compare that to how we write papers, it's the same. We start with some setting to understand the context, some problem, some gap in the literature. So we explain what we did, the action, present results, conclusions, and the implications, right? So when they have a discussion. So it's the same, we are storytellers. We communicate science via storytelling, even to ourselves. And when we are starting to talk about data, there is researchers who are already working in this area. It's called data-driven storytelling. It's beyond learning analytics. And this has been defined as the ability to turn raw data into easy to read and easy to understand plain stories, stories that people can understand. I recommend this book. This is very interesting. It has lots of examples, mainly from journalism, which is, again, journalists are using data increasingly to make points, especially nowadays during the pandemic situation. We always see the data, otherwise we don't believe what we are being told, right? So what happens in learning analytics, and this is my own work when I was in my PhD, we create dashboards. We create interfaces where we show some kind of visualization. Sometimes we go a bit deeper and show some notifications, etc. I really love this other example. I took this from a master's thesis, I think. I really like it because it has different widgets. And we have seen different dashboards in this way. This is not the only way to show learning analytics interfaces, but we create a lot of them for some reason. However, we already know that there's something going on with the dashboards. I've been following these systematic literature reviews about dashboards since 2017. Really, really cool papers, actually. This is four at the top. And there is one very recent literature review. And what I noticed is that they keep reporting similar things. The dashboards are not that easy to interpret, to act upon, really hard. And the last one is about, it's hard to understand what's the impact on learning for teachers. I haven't seen any literature review. If someone knows about literature review about dashboards for teachers, that would be awesome. This is the closest, Mangaroska and Janakus. And they also report similar things about interpretation, sense making, how to convert this data into something meaningful. And probably this is because of our simplified model of seeing the learning analytics loop. And I'm gonna stress simplify it. Maybe it's oversimplified, but let's see if you agree on how we sometimes consider the learning analytics loop. So we start usually with the user, which is, let's say, the learner, maybe the teacher. Let's just simplify this. It's a learner, and it interacts with some device, and that's how we usually it's a personal device. So now we have mobile devices or sort of things that the learners are using. And that's the way we capture data and we say, we can do something with the data and create analytics, show it to the device in the form of a dashboard And then we have this loop. And that has been not the general way to see learn analytics, but it's how it actually happens many times, including our work. And then we have more complexity. Sometimes we consider educators or other stakeholders. And sometimes we talk about collaborative work. So let's say that that's the oversimplified system, which is missing lots of things. And what is it missing? Missing things that are really hard to consider from a learning analytics point of view. If we shift the mindset and we think about humans instead of user, if you just remove the idea of interacting with the computer and logs and starting from the data and then we'll see what we can get. We can start with that complexity, which is humans have motivations, feelings, learning dispositions. So that's already complex. But also other things that are really hard to measure, even beyond learning analytics, which is consider personal issues, trauma, worldviews, trauma aware education is one thing that is actually is rare to see. And it's complex. All of these can influence learning. But we also have the complexity of the human interaction that can happen in different ways. It can be mediated or not by, by devices. Also, we have educators with also different motivations, feelings, positions, etc. So we cannot solve all the problems, but it would be good to understand the complexity from the beginning. And then we also have the notion in education about the learning design. We know that usually the educators create the task design, which is the epistemic side of design. It thinks about the tools, the set design, and also the social relationships. So that's social design. This is part of the ACAT framework from Wikipedia. And then that is important in education because it's an intention and then is realized in the activity. So the first question would be, do students and educators have a problem that can be addressed using their data? Because it's a system that is so complex that we cannot start just from the data, which is really complex and there's so many relationships. And of course, all the actors here interact with devices, and from these devices, we can get data. But we can see that already we're missing a lot, lots of detail about the system, which is fine. Our data is imperfect. And then another important step is to understand what's the meaning of that data. That's also something that is really important to explicitly think about it. And then we can create analytics in a more meaningful way once we have that realization. So let's say that this is a more complex system that is more conceptual, but at least to remember that our data is incomplete, that the system is really complex. And then how are we going to feed that anything that we get back to that system, which is intrinsically human? And here is why I say, well, maybe we need more stories. Maybe we need to understand that humans understand the world through stories. And I really like this quote by Yuval Noah Harari. Maybe I've heard him from his book, Sapiens. I really like this quote from here, his third book. Humans think in stories rather than in facts, numbers, or equations. So I immediately thought about, oh, facts, numbers, and equations. That sounds like things that sometimes put in a dashboard. So humans don't think in terms of dashboard, let's say, or in terms of the things that we put on the dashboards. So the rest of this chat is, I want to highlight three main themes, which I think somehow they're interconnected. So let's see how we go. The first one, of course, is human-centeredness. We've been talking about that. No? What is this idea of human-centeredness? And also what is not? From a learning analytics perspective, I was thankful to be involved in the first special issue on human-centered learning analytics. And this is the best we could put together as a potential way to see human-centeredness in learning analytics. And is that it's a system that is human-centered, is that has been designed by identifying critical stakeholders, relationships between them, and the context in which those systems will function. But to me, that's very broad. That can be pretty much anything. And that can also pretty much be what we are doing already. So a first notion to understand the difference between user-centered design and human-centered design, which sometimes are used interchangeably, especially if we are not in a design discipline, including myself, I've talked before, and even in the LAC in Sydney edition 2018, it was a call for user-centered design, which is fine, but as we're going to see, there are limitations. So from a user-centered design perspective, we start with the user. We observe the user as a researcher. This is not necessarily learning analytics, but it resonates a lot. We sometimes bring educational theory, and then we gain some insights. Let's say that we can also collect data on the way, and we can report, and we need to wear our hats of designers or just have someone else to build something beautiful that reports information either to the researchers or to the user again. And this is what we do already. So there's nothing, well, hopefully, this is usually what we do if we don't focus too much on data and we really want to observe. We bring some theory, we want to focus on the learner. We bring some theory and then we do something with the data. But from an emancipatory perspective for learner analytics, and I really like this paper by Chuniki, he mentions learners are not to be seen as passive beneficiaries of a superior control entity with respect to software adaptations. So he suggests that if learner analytics is gonna have a role in education, it should be limited to one of awareness and recommendation, which is what we know. That's why that's the recommendation. We only know that there are some tools for awareness and recommendations, but I think there are alternatives that we can also explore to avoid seeing the learners as passive beneficiaries. So one of those ways is when we start bringing this human-centeredness idea, which includes the notion of co-creation and co-design, which is to establish horizontal relationships with the users. Actually, they are not any more users because they can be other educational stakeholders that have a stake on those interfaces. It can be the learner, the teachers, it can be other stakeholders in education, managers, support teams, learning designers, et cetera, but bringing them at the same level as researchers and designers to build something together. This is a hard process, and I really recommend this book, this article at the bottom, which explains, yes, it's hard, but what are the benefits? And this is not something extremely new. It has started to be proven in other areas in design, so maybe it's worth it to consider. An actual original human-centered design definition is not so centered in just knowing the context and knowing the relationships between the stakeholders or the users, knowing the users, but it's about enabling individual and cultural conceptions to unfold into the interfaces with technology. So it's very deeper, and it talks about design, like really design for that activity and for that interface to occur in a way that the conceptions of people, the values are also considered. So it's really interesting, kind of the ideas that it changes, the ideas to change a little bit the mindset of how we develop these analytics systems. So I'm gonna now go through one example just to illustrate what we're talking about, human-centered design. And this is some work, most of the work is by Carlos Pietro. He is a former PhD student who brought his expertise on design and design thinking, especially. This is an adapted design thinking process. And with the idea, what he's pushing, the idea was he's been pushing is to bring teachers, learners, researchers, developers together in that process of co-creation. And he starts with these steps in design thinking about understanding, right? That's important, but that's not the whole thing, which is creating NFT and defining what needs to be done. So this is one example of our work led by people in Sydney Uni, which they were focused on sitting with teachers like and using what is called generative tools, which are tools for ideation to come up with the problems and understand the problems that the teachers, school teachers are actually facing. They were using sorting tools, voting systems to generate these ideas like without any restrictions. But also other tools can be used. This is called learner data journey mapping, but this coming from user journey mapping technique, which is a technique already used in websites to model how someone can have a success experience in chasing outcomes. But in education, it can be used to understand what are the pain points of the students, in this case, students in medicine who come to these simulated classrooms, and then what are the problems they're facing to identify the opportunities to have analytics in the classroom. And Carlos was doing some stuff with them that way. Then we have also the next step, which is creating, which in this case is asking the students or the teachers to actually give suggestions about how they want the interface to be put together. It can be by doing prototyping or simply by identifying what kind of information or evidence they want in the actual interface. There can be some other tools that can be used to develop the whole system. In this case, it's a card-based deck. And a few decks now in learning analytics, that's awesome to see, to give voice to all the different stakeholders, to see them around the table, students, teachers, designers, developers, to think about, okay, if we want to address this learning objective, we want all this to happen, what needs to be done in terms of money, time, resources, technologies, is this feasible or not? And then we have the delivery, and I like this example from Ken Holstein, who has been showing how we can come from these ideation tools on the left, just the superpower technique, you know, asking the teacher, what are these superpowers? If you have superpowers, what would you like to do in the classroom? To actual prototypes, high fidelity prototypes, in this case it's of an augmented reality tool to be monitoring the students in the classroom and actually presenting prompts to the students and teachers. This is what we've been doing as well for people in nursing education, creating and testing prototypes and deploying them before deploying them in actual scenarios. And then the last step would be support, but there are not yet many examples about support, which is something also that Carlos says. Well, we need this circular way to design and understand and keep working with stakeholders, which doesn't sound that unfamiliar to us because some of us have been doing design-based research where we have an iterative process of deploying in a educational setting, gaining knowledge, but also designing and going to the next iteration. So he proposed embedding this design thinking process into that DBR iteration. So this is something that will be cool to start seeing. We haven't seen any longitudinal human-centered design, design projects that actually show this or how it can happen. So how is that related to multimodality? So I've been doing work in multimodal analytics, but not with the purpose of doing it. It just happened. And part is because of this interaction. And that's why I highlight these orange arrows, because interaction here can be unpacked a little bit more. So I hope you don't hear the sound, because this is not intended. This is one example just for you to understand, that's why we need to think in terms of multimodal analytics. So we've been working with these kind of settings with nurses who enter into these rooms, into immersive rooms. So they need to role play whatever they have to do. It's like kind of like they have a mission, like they have a task, but they don't know what is the solution. They don't know what the task is. They need to figure it out. So they need to find information. They need to interact with computers. They need to interact with these patient mannequins, with each other, with actors. They need to perform actions. Talk, and they're also under stress, and then they need to also address stress, which is even things that are invisible. I really like this definition of multimodal data by Marcelo Worsley. Multimodal data is used in recognition of the plurality of ways that the students may demonstrate or communicate knowledge, interest, and intent, rather than thinking about the data itself. emphasizing the ways in which students demonstrate their skills, in which they need to develop their ability. So we came up with this vision of what happens if we can capture data using devices, forget about the sensors, they're going to be evolving for a long time. But we can get maybe logs documented in different ways with the goal of supporting the learning experiences that may be collaborative and realistic. And this is another definition of what multimodal learning analytics is. It can be argued, because it can be others. But the idea is that to start thinking beyond the computer screen. We know that the computer is disappearing. This has been happening in the last 20 years. The computer from being something that needed to be in a whole room with air conditioner, now is in our pockets. And even the mobile phone is a transition device. We don't use it as a mobile anymore, or maybe it's 10% of the time it's a mobile and other 90% something else. So we need to maybe start thinking about beyond the computer screen, because education probably is gonna go back to being rich, and the technology is going to reach in the sense of human-human communication, and also think about other ways in which we are not going to be able to be able to control the environment of someone being sitting next to the computer. It's not happening now yet, but it's happening little by little. The thing is that this happens, the technology is going that way. Anyway, and then, so what we have now with all the sensors, we have more complexity in terms, technical sense. We have this wristband that can generate lots of data about physiological data like this one. We have audio devices and the audio, you know, it's really hard to unpack it just without the knowledge on how to analyze it. And then we have also positioning data, which is also not that, we don't know how to analyze it. We can have orientation, posture, action logs from the system, maybe from humans, which we do and explore as well. So there's complexity there in the way we have all these data streams. So a way to start bringing human-centeredness and educational theory to give meaning to this data was proposed by Vanessa, another former student and now lecturer. And so she proposed this idea of sitting with the teachers to give meaning to this multimodal data, but starting from the higher order constructs, which are on the left, like for example, teamwork. They want to assess teamwork. How would they assess it? By looking at the communication. How do you assess communication? By looking at the speaker's interaction. And but also about physical participation, but there are some holes in the teacher's descriptions of how they assess teamwork. So we can, in theory, fill those holes and start connecting them with sensors or data that can be used to produce evidence that can be used to support the assessment of those higher order constructs on the left. This is still theoretical, but this will be really good to implement. And this is, I'm going to show you some examples on how we've been starting to implement this. One way to model this data, we proposed as the multimodal matrix inspired on quantitative ethnography, which was to start from the dimensions of collaborations and then looking at the logs, like for example, every second what's happening in the activity. And if there are different tasks, phases, then that can give meaning to the data as well. And then we have what we call multimodal observations, which is pretty much things like codes, coding our data into meaningful ways. So we can end up, instead of data streams or random waves of information, with ones and zeros or some scales that can be digested in an easy way. So for example, instead of having X and Y coordinates, we can map these into some codes that represent the positions of the image and the bed. And each of the columns represent, for example, if one nurse was next to the patient, on the patient, at the bed head, and we convert that into ones and zeros, and then that can be digested much easier by an interface. The same with levels of activity from the wristband and the accelerometers. We don't need the whole accelerometer data, but just a notion of, oh, for this particular activity, was it low activity, high activity in a CPR situation, for example, that's important. Or from EDA, was the nurse stressed or not, or was that aroused or not? And the actions, those are already kind of coded. Those are easier to code. And then with speech, it's a whole world as well. We can identify who's speaking, then start to look at a combination of different modalities, and if someone is speaking next to the other one, maybe the other one is listening, hopefully. And we're going to start to extract meaning from the multiple sources of information. So how is that related to storytelling? That's the next step. Well, first of all, what is storytelling in terms of data? So just going to do that little pause of examples, and let's go back to for definitions. And I really like this definition about data storytelling. It says it's an information compression technique for communicating insights to an audience through data, visuals, and narrative. So I highlighted those words because one is compression. It's compression of information, okay. That is technical. Insights, so we're not talking about communicating data anymore. And actually I've seen this word, communicating data. And what is important is to communicating insights. And we shouldn't be restricted to visuals. We also need to think in terms of the narrative, because that's what brings data storytelling into this field of finding that sweet spot of communicating something that's important. So I like this example. I would highly recommend this book, which is called Storytelling with Data. The focus is on businesses, but they have this beautiful example about education. So imagine that you have simple survey, not too complex data, simple survey, pre and post questionnaire about the satisfaction of the students in a program. So you can just choose these pie charts with lots of colors. And then, okay, how can we quickly understand what's the meaning of this data? Well, it's really hard to compare from one side to the other. It's like really hard to know what's going on here until we spend lots of time and cognitive effort to understand what's going on. But what about we start to digest in this data? It's already took us a few seconds, but we didn't get it, right? We didn't get it. But now we are represented in a different way, and we have a narrative. The pilot program was a success. Already that's a message. And then this on the right, there is narrative that says before the program, the children felt just okay. After the program, they were interested and excited. So they like it. So maybe this program worked before and after from this test. But there can be different ways to present that, combinations of visualizations and text, or it can also be just text. What we really want to do is to communicate the insight. You don't even need the visuals. There is no dashboard here anymore. It's just text. After the pilot program, 68% of the kids expressed interest. That's what is important to make a decision, which can be, let's repeat this in the next year. So really, like, this metaphor is sometimes we are going to need the visuals and sometimes we don't. So we try to bring this to learn analytics in the same context of nursing. And we created a few interfaces. This is one of them that we created with the teachers, very detailed. Each line is a student, a team of four, and each dot is an action they perform. It's not a classic learning analytics tool. It's just for one team. And it's more like a reflection tool, we call it. So it's not necessarily a dashboard. But still, this is hard to assess because what is the meaning of the order of these actions. And it needs also lots of, good sight because the text is small. And also it needs lots of meaning to understand and interpret. Did I do well or did I do something wrong? Well, that would be what a student would question. So we came up with this idea of layers in which the data is assessed based on the learning design of the teacher. And we add narrative to understand one story at a time. And this is the bottom of the interface, and the students can click. As an idea, they can click during the reflection phase, and they can see, like, for example, for this vital signs assessment, they missed doing it at some point in the simulations. Oh, we didn't do right, but it's giving feedback. And, but they did this second administering the antibiotic on time and all good. But then they didn't perform the ECG, we forgot. So the idea is to invite the student to reflect, and we capture the evidence for them and digest them a little bit for them to reflect upon. But also in terms of stress levels or arousal in this case, instead of showing them, trying to show them changes in the waves of electrodermal activity, we try to tag that information automatically to say, okay, be aware that you were very very aroused, very stressed at the end. So then this can trigger conversations about stress. There are other works that have been starting to spawn, and it's really awesome to see. Cora Wiley created a report. So it's more like a report, which is mostly narrative. And then there's some visualizations there just to make one point. And this is for teachers. So in this example from 2020, narrative is emphasized over the visuals. And this is about the visuals, how the narrative in navigation, this is another example from in InfoViz, in Pacific Viz conference, where there is a pathway to navigate the data in the dashboard. And the dashboard is not a dashboard anymore, it's more like a navigation tool. So we're going to wrap up, so I'll be aware of the time. And I wanted to just also mention that I was tempted to change the title and just not have end users in the title, but just have humans there. It was purposely done, it's just a joke. But I think I just wanted to catch attention that let's think about end users as well, but it's more about end humans, the ones who are gonna be in front of the analytics. So there are three takeaway messages I would like to stress, emphasize in this webinar. First, the human-centered approach is critical in the design of any educational technology, not only learn analytics, but it's more critical for learn analytics to start thinking about it like really, really seriously, because we know that AI, data analytics and surveillance tools are being developed really quickly. So if we don't develop them and we don't think about human centeredness, it's just gonna happen and vendors are going to do it anyway. Thinking about the complexity of human is important. The second one, how does that relate to multimodality? So this is a call to not to think in terms of sensors, not to think in terms of multimodal analytics or those guys who do to add sensors. No, it's another way to see it is to embrace the complexity of learning and human interaction, to identify all that complexity and think, okay, why am I just focusing on this evidence and what are the assumptions that I can make based on that incomplete data. And the last one is about data storytelling. Humans think in stories rather than in facts in dashboards, but actually this quote is incomplete. It also says, and the simpler the story, the better. So if we have a simple way to communicate those insights, that would be potentially more effective. And yeah, thank you. How am I doing with the time?
So yeah, great. We can do virtual applauses to Roberto to thank his great presentation. And now we would like to open the floor for discussion. We will do an easy question and answer format. There is already a question in the chat. Give me just 1 second to allow you to reactivate your mics in case you want. Dana, you posted a question in the chat. Do you want it to do it on your own, or I can read it to Roberto as you prefer?
I can read the question. Yeah.
No, but Dana is there. So
yeah. Sorry, I thought you were asking me if I want to say.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much, Dr. Roberto. It was a great presentation, and I really enjoyed a lot, like hearing. And I draw a lot on your work, actually, in my dissertation work. So part of my question is about the co-design. I highly see the value of the co-design, but I always think about the pushbacks and the struggle whenever you are co-designing with people. Like you have to end up choosing a certain pathway after the co-design. And my question is mostly, What decision do you take? Like if we are co-designing, for example, with teachers and students, and we have multiple of different opinions or things. So how do you take the further step and take an action to go with one versus another? And what, how do you, like, why is it this versus that, I think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hello, Dana. It's good to hear you again. Yes, super good question. I mean, there are like two or three ideas there that are really important. One is about the buying into the co-design process. Now, that's the first challenge, how to create that rapport institutionally, or even at the level of the classroom and the teachers. Is like, okay, how am I going to dedicate this time for doing this? And there can be always incentives for doing that. The main incentive naturally is to create better tools to avoid then rolling out a tool that is not useful. So from the administration point of view, I think that needs to be the first thing to do, is to convince the decision makers that this is important. And if they're going to have budget for this project, then to put budget there, they want things to be successful. So I think that needs to be the first motivation. Mm-hmm. There's lots of literature in the design. Maybe that would be the invitation to look at the how people in the co-design community deal with this problem, because it's not new. So one thing. The second thing when you mentioned is about how the designer makes the decisions once more. You need to advance, you need to progress, and you have potentially and most likely conflicting views, especially between students and teachers. And you also know that there are relationships of power already there. So teachers' voice may come more than the students' voice, right? So that is also an important thing to consider, even on defining a process to make those decisions. There is no one answer I can give, but that's definitely things that needs to be explored. That's something that, as I was mentioning, student Carlos, we were exploring the relationships of power and how that makes changes the whole thing. When you have a teacher and a student even in the same room, the student maybe is not going to be as open as if he's interviewed separately. So that's why I was saying, well, there are so many issues there. And I think the third one I was thinking was yeah, probably I forgot. It was long. You know, that's the whole process. So yeah, I mean, there is no silver bullet response to that, but I think we can try to learn from the co-design community. And I think that's our best bet at the moment, but also maybe participate in the human-centered initiatives that are happening. Workshop in ECTEL just 2 weeks ago, and hopefully in LAC as well. And do we need those conversations to start happening?
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both for enriching the discussion. I know that Anushka has a question. So maybe Anushka, do you want to do the question?
I do have a question, Roberto. I was really triggered by what you said about the computer leaving the classroom again. Which I never really thought about, but you're right. I mean, the devices are getting smaller. They're going into the pockets. And can you just reflect a little bit on what you think the future will hold for, yeah, in what ways technology will be part of the classroom?
Maybe I didn't express it properly. It was more like disappearing. And it's more about, I think it's the provocative, you become a kind of sentence. Which is the computer is disappearing. It's not going away, it's disappearing. So disappearing in the way we know it, disappearing from being a piece of furniture. Well, it's not a piece of furniture anymore. No? Before there was a lab, you know, and still is, but now sometimes it's like, no, we don't need a lab because the students are bringing their own device. So it's now disappearing from furniture. Now it's a personal device. And it's just gonna keep disappearing. I don't know what's gonna be the future, because that's beyond learning analytics. I think, I've been reading articles about how the mobile phone is just a transition device. And we can see it now. We have watches. Some people don't have laptop at home anymore. If they don't need to do certain kind of tasks. Some people now have at home just a tablet and a mobile phone, and with that it's enough. Or now people run businesses with a mobile phone. It's just like it's appearing in that sense, which is changing shape. So in changing shape, obviously there are going to be logs, but then we start thinking about, okay, a mobile phone is going to have, it already has lots of sensors in it. So you need to even think about, oh, let's put more sensors in there, but just more about thinking what, how the things are going on and thinking about how the classroom is evolving naturally. We don't need to do anything. The technology is going to be evolved naturally.
That's exactly what I meant. Like it's changing shape. So it's going to be just distributed in the classroom in tiny devices. And oh yeah, it's interesting to think about. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. In the chat, there was a question from Inga. I'm just encouraging people, but I also can read it. So the question is, how can you produce a useful story from data on what happened without having data on what are the goals of the participants or and without boring them with questions about their intents?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. Like, I guess if it's data storytelling, I don't know. The idea is to tell a story about data, but if we don't have data, then maybe I don't understand the question really well.
Maybe if you wanna jump in, but at least from my perspective, it's like, well, when you are measuring, you're expecting like an outcome, but then what happens with stories? Like, if not, you bias the story in a way. It's like, because it says what happened without having data and what are the goals? So it's like, oh, raise question, please jump in.
Okay, I hope you can hear me. Yeah. Good. I know that you can, it's frequently hard to interpret the data that you get from the behavior. If you have no information or little information about the didactic intentions of the teacher, what is it good for? You can derive different conclusions from the data in different didactic settings. And that's only the teacher side. As well, you have the student side. What are their intentions? And not everything that is, every story is useful for everybody. And as you already very right mentioned, information is very often incomplete, which mm-hmm. means you have to produce different stories and you have your incomplete information. So how do you deal with that? You can't ask give out mm-hmm. a questionnaire to everybody and then before every lecture, before you creating your story. So how do you do in practice?
Yeah. No, that, okay, I got it. That touches the point of the, also the risk. When we start thinking about data, we already think in terms of interpretations. So that storytelling, let's say, or storytelling is already being done in whoever tries to interpret data, right? They start to create a story and try to understand what's the story. The call here is to start designing for that process to occur. It's risky to create stories from complete data. And if we do storytelling automatically, it brings all that, this dilemma of who's making the decisions on the emerging stories and the interpretations of the data. So interpretations starts to be done automatically or through a different agent. Well, how we have been doing in practice is to take the learning design. So the learning design, the learning intentions of the teacher are converted into an algorithm. In our case, it's simple because we are working with nursing teachers where what they do is always play with algorithms. And usually it's very simple algorithms. Like if you do CPR, someone needs to be in this particular place and they need to be doing these certain things every certain time. It's pretty much so easy to create an algorithm to identify if that's correct or not. And with the data, it's very easy to interrogate. So in our case, and I think it works for this family of kind of in simulations where the students need to do certain things in certain order. There's protocols and they call them algorithms already. So what we create is an algorithm that can be read by the machine. And then we get also the feedback that the teacher would give them. And that's how we create the narrative. That doesn't work for everything, for all the especially open tasks, like are you a good collaborator or not? But I think even thinking in terms of the stories that can be created, that can be useful. But yeah, how we do it is pretty much creating algorithms that mimic the decision-making or interpretation process of the teacher.
Okay, so I see this is going to work for training, maybe more difficult for other learning situations. Thank you.
Thank you. What awesome question.
Yeah, tons of questions have appeared in the chat concerning how inspiring has been the talk. There is a question from Phil regarding the cervelli difficulty, like how learners might avoid that they perceive difficulty, but actually it's better for them so in order to be more productive. So how you could recommend to deal with this type of situations when a user avoids something that it's actually better for them?
What is the question? Sorry.
So the idea, yeah. Oh, Phil, are you from over there? But just to clarify, it's about like, for example, if you involve someone in co-design, like in a way, maybe he or she, they will recommend something, but it's not necessarily what they need.
Desirable difficulty. Yeah.
Can I help you with this, Roberto?
Yeah, probably. But,
I'm also intrigued by this issue with the validity of the intervention. And like our intervention is mainly, could be a comment on what the students do or what the learners or what the human we're examining is doing, or maybe something you change within their context or something you learn within the change within the like learning environment. So I was thinking that this has to be established with conversation between, for example, let's say students and teachers in my context. So that it has to be like a conversation and like a practice rather than it's, I recommend you do this to improve your learning, for example. So this like pinging feedback between you and the other person where they have an objective, you have some data, you tell them about how data can help them. It has to be like mutual input from both sides for it to work. As you said, it's a story. It doesn't stop with data. Data could be a formative input into the whole process, but not definitive, because it only tells you part of the story. We're focusing on behavior. We're discounting cognition, which is the most difficult part in the human like learning process. And what you get from the data, it tells you a little bit, because what they do changes all the time. We always reflect, we always change what we do. So it's not definitive at all. You try to understand, you try to reduce the way medical science did before and is doing, but it might not 100% work when you try to learn from learners' behavior, because it's simply about the cognition process as well and the decision making, which changes all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, now I got it after a while. We're talking about co-design. It was the hard to ship from the data storytelling question. So I have an answer for that. I was talking about the differences of power that we have been identifying when we have a teacher and a student in as co-design partners. We also have the differences of expertise. So including the students as co-designers doesn't mean that they make the decisions. They have a voice, but a student is not expert in pedagogy, for example. So recognizing the limitations of users is key. And that's something that also came up in research with Carlos and Simon Buckingham-Shum, where we were talking about the tension between having the teachers and the students. The teacher has expertise in pedagogy, so we can get lots of knowledge from that expertise. The student is expert in his own, in their own experience or her own experience. And that we need to recognize that. But then we cannot let, for example, a student to make decisions on pedagogical approaches, like pedagogical approaches that we really know that work, but the students may don't want to have it, which is, I understand, desirable difficulty would be the case. So it's maybe just to identify that by bringing students doesn't mean that we do all what the students want. but I think that has been a recurring question I observed in the last couple of years when we have that concern. And it's a valid concern. But you just maybe to recognize the expertise is not the same as all other things. And there's literature as well about expertise in relationships, relationships of expertise in co-design. So it's, yeah, it's gonna read more about it. And that would be very interesting to work on that. So while anyone is interested, it would be good to explore that aspect in learning analytics.
Thank you, Roberto, for that answer. I'm sorry if my intervention was confusing. Before we end, we would highly appreciate if you could briefly provide us feedback on this webinar. I'm gonna post a link in the chat to do so. It's a really brief survey. And I think we have maybe time for a last question. And there is a reflection here from David regarding how can learning analytics in a way could help us to appreciate and support the diversity of learners, because sometimes we end like in a way using data in order to learn to teach better the average student that actually doesn't necessarily exist. So what might be your take on that, Roberto?
Wow, that's the question. Wow, yeah, because that would be really embracing the complexity, right, of the systems, is understanding the uniqueness of each learner. And we often don't do that, you know, we treat learners as interchangeable pieces, especially in experimental settings where we have, oh, we have all these 10 students and these other 10, we do a comparative study. We are pretty much dismissing that diversity in doing that. So even maybe in our own, we need to start in our own research. And yeah, I've seen thesis talking about how we should avoid, I think by Phil, if I'm wrong, sorry, Phil, but about not the problems of having these comparative studies in education, because when we do that, we are neglecting that diversity and uniqueness of the experience of being a human and being a learner. So maybe starting with that. That's why I probably think, Anushka, you highlighted that authentic settings research, because I really love to do research where all these problems happen, when we cannot control who is in one group or the other. We even don't have groups or control groups and so on, because that's pretty much against acknowledging that diversity. Yeah.
Thank you, Roberto. And since we ran out of time, we will close the webinar soon. But before doing that, thank again Roberto and everyone for this insightful discussion. Hope this left you inspired. And if you want to keep track of and stay in hand in what is happening in Solar, I will share also a link to our mailing list, because we are having webinars every 2 months and you might be interested to keep up with that. And also I will share the link to where all the webinar materials are posted, the recordings there as well. So tons of links there. And thank everyone, and especially our presenter, and have a rest good of the day, depending on where you are, what time. Yeah, virtual applauses. Let's do that now that we're sharing.
Thank you. Have a beautiful day, everyone.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Roberto.
I'm going to stop recording.